Hi, I'm Paul Vunak. Welcome to the JKD Street Fighting Series. This particular tape is called Bruce Lee's Energy Drills. Hi, I'm Paul Vunak, and welcome to Energy Drills. First of all, let me tell you, what is energy? What exactly is the feeling of energy, or pressure, or sensitivity? You hear it called a lot of different names, and a lot of different arts have these drills. What it is it's the ability to read somebody's pressure. And if you're not in trapping range, you're not touching them, so it's a moot point. So this is only for arts that fight out of trapping range, such as Wing Chun or Kali. Now, for each art, they have a different energy drill, predicated on how the art is. For example, Wing Chun, their main battle punch is a straight blast. So their energy drills is two hands rolling this way. It's called Chi Sao, because that's going to be the way they're going to be in a fight. Kali, on the other hand, they like to zone and get to what we call zero pressure, which is one hand on, one hand off. This is why they have a drill called Hu Bun. So for each art, they have a different energy drill. What's unheard of, though, is to mix these drills. This is a whole different kind of animal. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, Brad, let me borrow you. I want you to see what I'm doing with energy, just to give you an idea. Let's say, for example, we're in a fight and we just clinch right here. Now, if Brad is pushing with this hand, all I want to do is just read where the energy is, and then boom, I can put in what I want. Headbutts, knees, elbows, later we're going to put the gear on him. But all I'm really doing with energy is learning to read to always get to zero pressure. So what we're not doing is we're not both fighting here, and then one guy gets the brainy idea to get up and headlock. What we're doing is we're just reading the energy and boom, we're going to go in and do our thing. So what we do is we have energy drills, and then we're going to do all of our techniques out of the drills. So let's pause for a moment, go back, think about this, now we're going to come in and do the drills. Thanks. Now with that in mind, what I'd like to do is go to our first energy drill. This is called the Lop Sao drill. What I want you to understand before we actually move on is you are not going to be able to gain energy from watching this tape. It's impossible. It'd be like watching Michael Jordan play basketball and learn how to jump. It's an attribute. But what I can give you is I can give you the structural points. And once you understand those points, then you get in with a man who does know energy, and then you can flow. So that's the whole key here. We also want to point out the fact that during the course of these energy drills, whether it be a Filipino energy drill like Hu Bun, or a Chinese energy drill like Chi Sao, we can implement other arts, other nationalities. As Bruce would say, using no way as way. So these are the points I'm wanting you to get, is that we're going to try to flow, try to be natural. I'm going to show you the structure of the hands, and then I'm going to show you how you can implement different arts out of that. But you're not going to get energy, so let's be real about that. All right, let me bring you in there. Now, the first drill is called the Lop Sao drill. It's a very easy drill. I want you to think of your elbows as pinned together, like there's a pin through your elbows. What we're going to do with this hand is I'm going to pull this down, and I'm going to come in backhand. He's going to bong sao with his front hand. Now, he's going to do the same thing to me. And all we're doing is we're doing this drill over and over again. From this position, let's shift here. We're going to go very slow. Now, you're going to have some Wing Chun people saying, nah, straight all the time. Do it again. Other one's going to go, well, let's go to the backhand. Other one's going to go, oh, look at his form. Jesus, toes out that way. We're not the perfect. The point Bruce was trying to make is it doesn't really matter where your big toe is. The key is that you have the right energy and you have an athletic movement when you do it, hopefully with a little intensity. All right, so I'd like you to try that in the mirror. Now let's pick up where we left off. We're going to continue with the Lop Sao drill. Then from there, we're going to go to Hu Bun and then Chi Sao. Remember, we're learning just the shells. We're not going to throw any strikes out of these. We just want to show you the form. We want to show you how we're just moving around. We're not really knowing where we're going. We're not planted here. We're not in any particular pigeon-toe position. We're just moving around a little bit. We just want you to get a feel for what it looks like. Okay, there. Most important thing is that we attach the elbows. Now, when I get to this point, right when I backhand, if I grab this and pull, now we're on this side. There's something real strange about this drill. When you do this for a while, and then you're in a fight and he punches, the minute you get this reference point right here, boom, that's your Lop Sao. Anytime you get some kind of cohesion here, you're going to be the first one to do that. Why? Well, because we're rolling here. This is our neighborhood. We're staying here. We play here. We know every little nook and cranny from this position. Now, who do you think is going to come out first the minute you're here? Boom. That's what we're looking to get. So what the lopsaw drill does is it teaches you how to get a hold of a handle. The minute you feel that handle, then you pull it. And that's just the beginning. That's our entry. All right, now you try it. Now we're going to move on to hubud, which is our next energy drill. I'd like to start you off with the sticks and show you how it transfers to empty hands. Okay, Larry? Okay, we're going to start off in long range, in largo mono range. We're going to break in, we're just kind of flowing, and then we're going to get into hubud, the energy part, which where it's close quarter. Okay, long range. See, right here, right about here, this is our energy part. This is where I'm pushing, but as I push, he raises to borrow that energy. He's going to slap right here and boom, come back down. So it's always a cohesion and then a slap and then a strike. So it's a touch and go as opposed to the Wing Chun way, which is two hands are touching at the same time. And once again, why is that? Well, it's indicative of the art. When somebody throws a punch at you, you're going to zone. The minute you zone, one hand will be on the check, your other hand's free to hit. Larry, let me borrow you again. Throw a jab. Notice what I'm going to do is I'm zoning to here. So there's one hand on, one hand off. Get this angle, do it again. Boom. Now, as if I were a Wing Chun man, as soon as he jabs, boom, I'm coming in this way. Now two hands are coming in. So why hubud? Well, it's one hand goes, one hand releases. Okay, now let's make the transition to the empty hands. Larry. Now, if he had a stick in his hand, the angle would be coming down at number one. So we're going to do the same thing. As it comes down, I'm going to catch it. I raise, slap, and I hit. When you see us doing this in demonstration or seminars, we always exaggerate the angle and pull it out so people can see. Not the way to do it. Eventually, you want to tighten it up. It's almost like a Wing Chun thing where you're in center line. So the next drill we're going to go to is called hubud. And what I want you to say to yourself is raise, slap, and hit. Raise, slap, and hit. For people that already know hubud, we're going to boost it up a little bit and go full contact with it. But for right now, if you don't know it, just work that sequence. Now we're going to move along to chi sao. This is an energy drill from Wing Chun. Very, very difficult to teach. All the movements are very, very intricate. What I'm going to do is I'm going to try to give you a shell. And once again, you're going to have to find somebody that knows it. Once you've got that shell, then you can get their energy, as opposed to spending 4 years learning the role, going from Dan Chi and moving you all the way up. Peru said, we don't need that. Let's just go right into Chi Sao. We don't need a pigeon-toe position. We don't need the, you know, he just said, just make it athletic. So this is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to pay particular attention to where your big toe is. We're not going to worry about if this is here or here. I'm just going to give you the basic shell. All right, Larry, before I do this, I want you to understand why Chi Sao is the way it is and how many positions there are, which are four. In a fight, you're either going to have two hands on the inside, two hands on the outside, Larry's two are on the outside, one in, one out, or one in and one out this way. That's it. One, two, three, four. If we're in the boxing scheme, give me a jab and parry mine, bam, bam, this is where we are. Give me a little cohesion here. Yeah, and we're stuck right at this point. If, let's say, he swings at me twice, boom, boom, and we're stuck here now. I may come in with this jab, boom, and we're stuck here. So for whatever position or for whatever reason, you're going to get stuck in one of these positions. So we say, hey, well, let's come up with a drill. So when you get there, you can read his energy and be the first to get in. There's an old saying, the firstest with the mostest is the bestest. So the first shot you want to get in is to read that energy. And then that's when it hits the fan. Okay, now let's start on the chi sao. The very first position we're going to use. One hand is on the outside, one hand is on the inside. My hand on the outside, my elbow has to be in. The single most important thing about Wing Chun is that you're occupying center line. This is why we do not end up on the ground if we're a good Wing Chun man, because we're occupying center line. If you're a Wing Chun man and you get in a fight and you end up on the ground, there's absolutely something wrong. So now, from this position, my elbow being in, his being right here. Now, this is called a Phuc Sao. I'm not going to pay too much particular attention with the terminology. But this is called the Fuk Sao. If we turn it this way, it's called a Tan Sao. But regardless, the elbow is still in. Larry on this end is going to go to either a Bong Sao or it's going to return back to a Tan. Okay, so this hand here is staying in and I'm always staying in the middle. Now let's shoot over to here, Larry. Now we reverse it, where this hand is on a Fuk Sao and this hand goes from Bong to Tan. So what we end up doing, what it's going to look like, is it's going to look like we both have a ball in our hand and we're rolling with it. But the key is one elbow has to stay inside. Let's just say, for example, if I'm like this, and I do not have anything occupying center line and Larry doesn't, for whatever reason, we clinch right here. Where are we going to end up? Right on the ground, if we don't get headbutt first. However, if that same clinch position happens, bam, and I'm in center line, I've got control. This is where I can control the fight. If Larry wants to come down to tackle me, see, I'm always in center line. And then that's when you're going to put in your thing. All right, now let's take it from the beginning. He's in a Fuk Sao, he's in a Tan Sao. Now what's really happening is this is staying right here and just this is turning. Okay, now this is going to roll from a Tan up to a Bong. Okay, so give me a roll, Larry. Now if you're noticing here, this bone right here, this is called the humerus, is staying in. This is not moving. This is representing the, go ahead and raise your Bong Sao. This is representing the hand that's on the outside. And the reason this hand doesn't move is because he wants to occupy center line. He needs to be here. If that elbow moves up, boom, I'm in. As soon as I see that elbow moving up just a little bit, just that enough, boom, that's going to go in. If we're in a fight and the minute I clap, bam, I'm going to go in first. That's the first thing you do is you find center line. If when I write him at this point, I get some kind of energy with his hand, that's when you come in and boom, do your thing. But the key is you've got to be in center line first. Can I borrow that belt? Okay, here's a real easy way to do this. Just to kind of get you used to keeping one hand in, what we're going to do is we're going to put a little belt on Larry here. And now that's going to prevent this arm from really doing anything. Let me tighten that up a little bit, Larry. There. Now, notice what he's doing. Just this wrist is going to turn. Okay, go ahead. Face the camera a little bit more, Larry. There you go. That's it. And now walk a little bit. Just walk normal. Just so you want to get the feeling of just walking normal. We're not putting ourselves in any particular stance. Okay, good. Thanks, Larry. Okay, so here's what we've established. The hand that's on the outside occupies center line. This bone does not move. It stays right here. This hand is going from Tan to Bong. And together, it's sort of formulating this look. Now, once again, I cannot give you energy. It's impossible to give energy through a videotape. But you can get the form. And then when you lock up with somebody in Chi Sao, hopefully through a sort of an osmosis, you'll get the energy. See, Chi Sao is a funny thing. You get the energy from training with somebody. You tend to feel the way they do. Dan was on the end of Bruce for 9 years. You know, being on the end of Dan for 15 years, I'm very fortunate because I have that feeling of Dan. Not quite as good, but the feeling is there. Okay, let me borrow a ball. All right, if we just take this ball and if we hold it in this position and this is here, this is kind of the feeling that I want you to represent. I just want to try every analogy I can to get you to relate to this. Notice my left hand is not moving. So first we tried the belt, now we tried the ball. Okay, this hand here, it's like you're looking at your watch. For my New Yorkers, pouring a beer, whatever. All right, so we're right here. Tan Sao, Fuk Sao. Roll, and come back down. And that's Chi Sao. Okay, Larry, now let's put it together. My hand is on the outside, his is on the inside. His hand's on the outside, mine's on the inside. We make our first roll. This is our position. Now we roll from here. Notice his left forearm is not moving. It's staying in center line. Notice my left forearm is not moving. It's staying in center line. This is what we call the shell. From this shell, there's a myriad of techniques we can do. We don't even need to stay in Wing Chun. We're going to be borrowing from Kali, from Thai boxing, from Tai Chi. But right now, I want you to get the shell of the three arts. All right, let's play with it. Now we have all three drills, the Lap Sao drill, Chisao and Hubut, coming from different nationalities. What's important now is that we blend them together. If you have just the energy of, let's say, a Wing Chun man, and you're in and you're forward, and both hands are on, that's great. If you have just the energy of, say, a Kali man, where you're perpetually zoning, well, that's good too. A Wing Chun man occupies centerline. He's forcing his opponent to hook, and when he hooks, he's going straight. Great concept. Kali, on the other hand, gives centerline. Now he's forcing his opponent to come straight, and he's zoning. Another good concept. When you mix the two together, you get a whole different animal. So what we're going to do to segue into being able to mix these together is we're going to do it in the drill. We're going to do all three shells, and then I'm going to take one art at a time or one technique at a time, and we're going to slowly, with a progression, integrate these into the shell. And if we do that, if we can pull off Panatukan or Panajakman or arm wrenches or headbutts or locks or flips or throws, if we can pull those off together while we're sparring within the confines of an energy drill, then when the street fight comes, we can pull off our techniques. This is why we have so many people that know so many techniques. I see it all over the world, black belts with know zillions of techniques, but they can't use them. What's the problem? They know how to do the technique, but they don't have the attribute to support it. If you don't have the attribute, you can't do it. You can't pull it off. So what these energy drills give you is they give you the attribute to pull it off. Doesn't have to be the drills I'm going to give you. It could be any energy drill you want. It could come from Tai Chi or regardless. All right, Larry. Start off with a lop style drill. We start with the elbows attached once again. And boom, we're just going back and forth. I'm going to shift here. Go to Hubud. See, he doesn't know what I'm going to do. I might all of a sudden just change drills. We're just sort of flowing. We're going from one structure to another. Notice there's no hits right now because we're just doing the drills. Let's slow everything down just a little bit here. Okay, so see if you can recognize what drill we're doing. I shift to this position. Everything we're doing here, you need this. You need this particular mechanics. For Hubud, you need this particular way to move. For Chisao, you need this particular way to move. They're all like two halves to a whole. So what I'd like you to do is blend all three shells together. We'll be right back. Now what I'd like to do is take the three energy drills we worked, the Huba, the Chi Sao, and the Lap Sao drill, and slowly start to add elements to it, or arts to it. First one we're going to do is Dumog. This is Dumog, okay? We're doing Huba. This is the shell, but once again, we're trying to find a position where we do a little pull. So we're just learning the reference points of when to pull. Obviously, each pull is going to be into a tool. But instead of starting from a locked out position and trying to come in like this and do a technique, we want action. We want movement. We need to borrow that motion right there. There's a split timing when we need that. So this is why we're doing it out of hubad. We're feeling the appropriate time to get that little pull. If I want to work off the left hand, I come here. Now it's the same pull on that side. We get back to here. If I want the inside shot, boom, I've got that pull. If I want to go to his neck, I know I have to trap up both hands. So when I come here, boom, I trap the hands. That's my first pull. If I want to go back the other way, I trap up both hands again, and I walk this way. So we have complete control of the body out of hubad. And then eventually what's going to happen is he's going to counter me. And every time I go for a pull, he'll go for a push, and it becomes sort of like a sparring match. Except we keep our form because we're staying in the confines of hubad. Now let's add another art to hubad. This art's going to be Tai Chi. Tai Chi is Chinese, hubad's Filipino, once again using no way as way. Now the thing I want you to understand when we do our Tai Chi, we don't go through the sets per se. We're not quite as meticulous on the form. You have to understand that in real good Tai Chi men, it's very combative. And they're throwing each other around. Back in the old days when they'd go inside and they'd beat the hell out of each other with the Tai Chi, then they'd go outside and sort of cool down. And you'd see them going through their sets. And someone would say, "What are you doing?" They'd say, "Tai Chi," because they're cooling down. But the problem is, because that has happened over the years, people don't understand what these motions are for. You can go to Hong Kong right now and see 50,000 guys out here. "What are you doing?" "I have no idea." Okay? The point is, what we're trying to do, Bruce, all he wanted to do is just implement Tai Chi at that one point in a fight where you need to push somebody. And there is a time and there is a place. It's not the mainstream. It's incidental, if not accidental. But you could be doing this, boom, boom, a little card going by, and bam, that's where you need your Tai Chi. So what we're going to do is we're going to do Tai Chi out of hubad. Larry. Okay, now also what we're doing, we're just starting doing our normal hubad. The first move I want to do is I want to trap up both of his hands. Then I just give a little shove, and then we just go back to here again. So that's all we're doing, our first move. Let's check it out in this angle. There. We're moving around. I trap, shove, and get back to here. Notice when I shove that I'm following him. As soon as I get there, bam, I'm following right back in, because in reality, probably as soon as I came here, boom, that's where a kick would come. But what I want to do is I want to follow in so we can go back to the drill, keep the continuity. So there are different positions we can do. Just a little shove here, and I go back to hubad. I come in this position, boom, a little shove here, and we're back to hubad again. So the key is that every time we do a move, we somehow go back to the center. We go back to the hubad. That's how we keep our continuity. Now let's add another art to hubad, and that's locking. I'm not going to give it a name because every art in the world's got locks. I'd like to talk a little bit about locks with you. First of all, a lock is, once again, incidental if not accidental. You never look for a lock. The best way to take a guy out of commission, damn, is with a ballistic hit. When you're looking for a lock, going against the joint and then trying to apply the appropriate pressure, that's difficult. Murphy's Law squares itself. So what we want to do is we want to use locks, but just have a particular place for them. That's the whole key. Let's say your buddy's at a party, he's got a chandelier on his head. Okay, you don't have to say, "Larry, you've been drinking too much." Boom, you're not going to headbutt him and carry him out. You might grab him, put him in an arm lock, and carry him out the door. Okay, for whatever reason, you want to restrain somebody. But I'll tell you something, if you're looking for a restraint and not to take somebody out, and you got a 6'5" Samoan pissed off running at you, the last thing I'm going to be doing is sitting there going, "Where's that wrist lock?" Okay, so locks are, once again, incidental if not accidental. Okay, with that said, let's move on. Larry. Okay, we're doing hubad. I'm going to go down the body. Okay, first lock, let's just go right to the wrist. Want to get on the second side, boom. One list here. Now we want to move on to the elbow. That's our first elbow lock. We're going to shift on the elbow on this side. That's the same thing on that side. See, as we're doing hoobite, what you're doing is you're feeling the locks that feel good to you. You'll feel it. He's telling me what to do. I don't know what I'm going to do. Throw a jab, Larry. Okay, boom, I come in, boom, and that happened to be the lock I was into. I didn't know I was going to get there. I just happened to come in again. Boom, that's Dumog. It just happened to be into Dumog. We'll survive. We go here, we've got to go his foot sweep. So the point is, you never know what you're going to do. It's just incidental, if not accidental. Now what I'd like to do is work the bottom half a little bit. Let's put in some of the kicking arts. I want to first talk about Savat and Pananjakman. Pananjakman is a very, very good art for the street. As far as aesthetics, well, I wouldn't give it exactly a 10. Pananjakman's main attribute is that whatever you're doing on the upper line, you can be kicking on the lower line. And this is very, very rare. Normally, when you throw a kick, your whole upper body has to be contorted in a particular position. Your body is convoluted to where you can't do a strike. Pananjakman, on the other hand, from the waist down, you're doing one thing. From the waist up, you're doing something else, sort of like a drummer. And when you're hitting Pananjakman, you're taking the groin, the knee, the tendon behind the knee. They have a lot of nice little shots. So we like to integrate Pananjakman in Hubud. Now with Savat, it's sort of the same thing. The only difference is they kick above the waist. Now in reality, we don't usually like to kick above the waist. If we're in a street fight, we keep it below the waist. But for training, for sparring, very nice. The main thing about Savat is if the kick goes out at 50, it comes back at 100. It's a shoe art. So basically, you're not kicking barefoot, you're kicking with a shoe, and you're just zipping. You're just popping the kick out quickly. They like to attack the organs, the kidney, the solar plexus, the groin, up to the jaw even. So Savat will box with their feet, a lot like Bill Wallace does. He's almost doing Savat. They do it with both legs. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to combine Savat and Pananjakman. I'm going to put them both in Hubud. So you're going to see the hands doing one thing, but the legs doing something else. So we're training in this multiple coordination. Then when the street fight comes, well, hopefully we'll move that way. Okay, Larry. Okay, so we're doing Hubud. The first kick I want to show you, we have two possibilities of doing it. One from the inside and one from the outside. It's called an oblique kick. And so that's the first shot. Boom, that's all I'm trying to do. Remember, it doesn't look good. As I come on this side, boom, that's the second shot. So you two oblique kicks, boom. Or boom. The second shot comes around here and the heel digs into the tendon. All these are very ugly. You gotta feel them to appreciate them. So instead of that, what we're gonna do is we're gonna slap. Boom. I'm just slapping the leg. That's all I'm doing. Instead of doing that, I'm doing that. If we're on this side, you see the same thing. First shot, bam. Okay, so all the little heel hooks, we're gonna be doing that while we're doing Hubud. Now, if I wanna move it up a little bit, notice the minute he blocks that, boom, that's my Savat shot because I can sneak that in. So as we're going here, I might go low here, or I might come up, boom, and put high up here. Savat can kick high, close quarter. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to find those insertion points just when there's an opening, and then put in either Pananjakman or Savat. Now for the last couple elements that we're going to add into Hubud, we're going to put in foot sweeps and nerve destructions. First of all, you need to understand that there is no set limit to how many things you can put in Hubud. Just for our constraints of time, I'm going to keep it within about 5 or 6 different techniques or arts or concepts. Okay? You can put in what you want. As long as you're doing it out of an energy drill, chances are you're going to be more functional when the street fight comes. So that's what you got to understand. Now let's get back to nerve hits. I want to show you that with parts on the body that we like to hit, how we like to hit them and where, and the main reason is why. It's not predicated on a person grabbing you. A person grabs me, I'm going to poke him in the eye or knee him in the balls, period. This is predicated on if you're chasing a guy, you're blasting him, and he puts his hands up, and bam, you just take that nerve, kill the hand, then you go back to the face again. Or say he throws a jab, and you're taking the nerves out in the arm there. Now he's here. Very few people come back and hit you with his hand. Pretty much the fight's over from here. He gets that flinching reaction. Then we go into this. So the nerve hits are not an end in themselves, they're just a means to an end. Now foot sweeps, which is the other element we're doing out of Hubud, is very similar in the fact that we don't look for it. You're punching, you're kneeing, you're elbowing, you're arm wrenching, and there's a leg there. It's like, oh, you just gotta go for it. And you sweep it, just a nice ending. I wouldn't, once again, chase that foot sweep against a guy 6'5" and pissed off. All right, Larry, come on in. Can I get a magic marker? Great. All right, now let's follow the nerves on the body where we want to attack. First of all, we like the back of the hand. From the back of the hand, we're going to go down here until we hit muscle. This is the muscle mass of the forearm beginning. So we have all of this in here as nerves to hit, all the way up to here. Now, once we hit muscle, we're going to make a beeline to the left, coming up the arm right to here. And this is about the size of a quarter. Okay, so let's look where we're at here. So right here, and coming down the arm to here, going to here. As we move on this side of the arm, this is going to go directly across to the joint, and right here is your funny bone. It's your funny bone because it's connected to your humerus. Shh, don't say that. All right, so we're going to go from here, we move around to here, we come down the arm, right where we hit bone, a ton of nerves. That's all you want to do, just get that reaction all the way down to the back of the hand. Okay, so let's do that out of hubut. So what we're doing is we're sitting here going back and forth. First shot I'm going to make is there. Boom, I'm going to take that nerve. So let's look at it again. Right when I'm here, bam, that's when I'm taking that. Now, if I were in a fight, and if I had this reference point right here, why would I want to hit that when I can hit that? Well, I wouldn't. But the point is, when you're blasting this guy, and he's running out of his way, just kind of give me a backward energy. So as I'm coming in here, yeah! Then boom, that's when you kill the hand. The minute you kill the hand, boom, that's when you can come into all this. You can't do that unless you got the arms down. So we like to do it out of hubut. Just going back and forth. Want to work the left hand, we just come in this side, boom. Take it right across, aiming for the nerve down here. So we're doing our nerve hits out of hubut. Now we want to add the foot sweeps. So to do a foot sweep, I have to trap both hands up to get here. Now I'm in sweeping position. Okay, once again, it's the icing on the cake. If I want to go the other side, I'm just coming around here. Now I'm in sweeping position here. A little bit longer to travel, but if you're hitting, that'll make up for it. So, two more elements we're adding. Foot sweeps and nerve hits. Now for our second drill, the lapsaw drill, and we're going to start adding elements out of that. For sake of time, I'm not going to break them down. You've got the basic idea now. So you're going to recognize when we're doing a lapsaw drill, if you see a savate shot, if you see a foot sweep, you'll get the idea. Just got to keep in mind that the arts and the elements that I'm putting in right now are not the end in themselves. You can put in anything you want. You want to put in penjat salat in there? Go ahead. Any art you want to put in, you throw in judo, anything you want. Once again, the key is you're doing it out of an energy drill. Okay. So now we're going to change energy drills, which gives us a different feel, gives us the ability to fit in with different people. That's a lapsaw drill. It's the first one we showed you. And out of that, I'm going to be throwing in different arts. Okay, Larry. Okay, now basically we're doing our lapsaw drill, but from this position, if I want to put in a dumog shot, I'll put in a dumog shot. If I want to go lapsaw on this side, it's the same thing. I'll go here. Okay? So we might flow back to hubut. The energy might take us there. All of a sudden, we go back to this again. Okay? When we get back to this position, boom, I might come up and just give a little savate in. Let's go then on this side, give it a little angle. So watch when I'm open for savate. Right, boom, right there is where you got to put it in. Now look, we just happen to flow into hubut. We go to hubut on this side, and we're in the lapsaw drill on this side. From this lapsaw drill, I come out, and I'm back into a foot sweep. Move back up, and boom, we're back into hubut. Oh, back to lapsaw. So we don't differentiate from what art we're in, what culture, what energy drill. That's absurd to us. All we look at is what is functional. There's no superior art all the time. So what we're trying to do is find the superior art at the moment. And you're not going to be able to do that in combat when the heart's doing this, unless you've trained it, and you have to train it in an energy drill. Gradually, that energy drill has to get more and more combative until we can put the helmet on and go for it. Now let's move to our last energy drill, Chi Sao. Remember, Chi Sao is Chinese. We don't do it exactly the way Wing Chun people do it. Bruce modified it. He changed from the particular pigeon-toed stance, he moved it around a little bit, he threw in the footwork, made it a little bit more aggressive, and most importantly, he put in other elements outside of the realm of Wing Chun. Think about this. Every art that you go to, if you were to walk into a Taekwondo school, a Kempo school, a Tung Sudo school, they always assume that you're going to get into a street fight with someone from that art. When I was in Taekwondo, I was blocking kicks, a bunch of high kicks all day, doing X blocks in the bar, a guy's gonna throw a high kick at me. When I was in Hung Gar Kung Fu, I was blocking crane's beaks and tiger claws. When I was in Kempo Karate, it was back fists and reverse punches. Okay? The thing is, you're going to get come at from every conceivable angle. in different rhythms, different ways, different people. So you have to be able to fit in. You can't stay in the confines of one little shell. It's like eating spaghetti all your life. You've got to try other things. And the more you investigate these other things, the better you're going to be able to fit in, like water fitting into a container. If it goes into a round container, it's round. Goes into a triangular container, it's triangular. You need to be like water. And in order to do that, you need to have several different training methods. But this gets us to one other point, the eclectic martial artist. People that sit there in the armchair, they read about this art or that art, but they don't really do it. So what we need you to do is we need you to actually get in and box. I mean really box. Get about 5 or 10 fights. Get in on the mat and wrestle. Get in with a Thai boxer and go for a couple of years and do some Thai boxing. You actually have to delve yourself and put yourself in that field. And then when you do that, then you kind of step back from over here and you look at the big picture. You say, yeah, Thai boxing is great, but I don't know if I want that in it for the street fight. Oh, Wing Chun's great, but I'd like to add that a little bit. But the only way you're going to have that educated eye in order to know what to absorb and what to reject is to actually get in and do it. Now we're going to do Chi Sao, but we're going to do everything out of Chi Sao. We can do a little savate, do a little Thai boxing, we'll probably float a Hu Bud. I have no idea. And this is how we train. Okay, Lair. So we're rolling. The first thing is we have no clue or care or bearing where our hand is at, okay, or where our feet are at. If my hand's here and I'm rolling, I don't care. If my hand shifts to here, I don't care. I wouldn't even know if I'm in left-handed Chi Sao. We may go right to Hu Bud right away. Right here, we go to here. We have no idea what we're going to be doing because our energy is dictating it. Right now, I feel like a little savate. That's the way I feel. This gives me a little Wing Chun here. Oh, God, that foot sweep, it's there. You can just feel it. So what I'm trying to do is I'm just trying to get myself in a position where I'm hitting and trying to do what I want to do out of an energy drill. That's the key. Then when the street fight comes, you're already there. You've got the attributes. Now, if you'll notice how I structured this, I have all of the energy drills on one side. We have Chi Sao, we have the Lop Sao drill, and we have Hu Bud. Now from there, out of any of those drills, we have our list of elements on the other side. Now I'm just going to keep it to 10, but once again, this list could be endless. You can put in any art you want. The list is Dumog and Tai Chi, Locking, Pananjakman, Savat, Thai Boxing, Sweeps, Nerve Hits, Headbutts, knees, and elbows, and panantukin. These are the basic arts that we chose to put in. Once again, you can put in whatever you want. Each one of those arts corresponds with one of the or all three of the energy drills. And this is how we get functional at the actual techniques in those arts. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take all three drills, Lop Sao, Hu Bud, and Chi Sao, and we're going to move it up one notch, and just one notch. Remember what I said before, the key to being able to do this in a street is a progression. You need to go from A to B to C to D. Okay? The first thing you need to do is you need to learn techniques out of the different arts that we use. We don't need to learn all of the techniques. Of course, it could take a lifetime to learn Tai Chi by yourself. However, if we just take a few moves out of Tai Chi and functionalize them, that's good enough. So Bruce picked about 5 or 10% of each one of the arts we're speaking of. Savat, just take a few kicks. Fencing, we took those stop hit. So what we're going to do is we're going to take all of these different arts, gradually do them harder. And the way we're going to do that is I'm going to be doing the drills with Larry, and he's going to have the helmet on. The next phase would be I put the helmet on also. Can't talk very well with a helmet, so we're going to just stick with one helmet. But the next phase is we're both doing it, so we're sparring. And then gradually we get to where we're going a little harder, and then we're done with the drills. We've done the techniques out of the energy and the confines of the drills, and we have good form. Now, we do no more drills. We'll do them once a week to tune up, and now we spar it. And when you spar it, you've got to have gloves on. One side's got gloves, and he's got a helmet on. And you just tell him, go for it. And you just do what you got to do. And the thing is, the more people you can do that to, the more people that you can stick that motorcycle helmet on, throw a pair of gloves on them, I don't care who they are. Clumsy, fat, skinny, karate, taekwondo, it doesn't matter. Thai boxers, that's the key to a JKD man. Having that wisdom to know how to flow from one opponent to the other. And this is the segue that's teaching you that. And as I've said before, there are no secret techniques in JKD. If there are secrets, they lie within the training methods. Okay, Lur. Now, what we're going to be doing, the key is that we're going to roll at the same speed we normally would. Just because he has a helmet on, we don't all of a sudden speed up our roll or our lop or our hoobud. If we're going to do hoobud, we're going to go about the same energy. The only thing I'm trying to do is I'm trying to find out where there's an opening and hit it. That's all I'm trying to do. If we move to this position, it's the same thing. As I'm punching here, this is about the speed I'm going, but if I want to sneak one in, that's what I'm trying to do. So here's our roll. Instead of going on the chest, bam, I'm just trying to hit this. Then we go right back to a roll again. If we go to hoobud, going back out the same thing. When put bam, put this in, it's the same. But boom, put the headbutt in, it's the same thing. But instead of simulating it here, all I get to do is I get to bury it. And that's what I'm looking to do. When I can bury that headbutt, then I can bury the knee. But we're doing it and going right back to hoobud. That's the key. We're staying within the confines of these drills and boom, just putting it in when we want. That's how you're going to get functional. Well, I hope you enjoyed energy drills. What I'd like you to understand is there is only one phase in the street fight where we're really using this. I'm going to quote Dan. All of the kickboxing you've ever done all your life is for about the first 10 seconds of the fight, just to get that entry. Once you've got that entry and you start hitting the face a few times, those hands are going to fly up. With the minute the hands fly up, there's a feeling, there's a pressure. That's where your energy drills come in, just for that split second. All of the chi-sao, all the hoobud, all the lop-sao we've ever done, all of our life is for the next part of that fight. The second you feel that pressure. Now, once you get that boom, that first shot in, then you're into the headbutts, the knees, and the elbows. So this is what we want to do. We want to segue from kicking, boxing, to doing the energy drills, and then finally learning the proper way to headbutt knee and elbow. Thanks a lot.
I can't understand. Are you reeling in the years, stowing away the time? Are you gathering up the tears? Have you had enough of mine? Are you reeling in the years, stowing away the time? Are you gathering up the tears? Have you had enough of mine?
You were 17. In all the time I've known you, I still don't know what you mean. The weekend at the college didn't turn out like you planned. The things that pass for knowledge I can't understand.
Are you reeling in the years, stowing away the time? Are you gathering up the tears? Have you had enough of mine? Are you reeling in the years, throwing away the time? Are you gathering up the tears? Have you had enough of mine?
Thank you. I spent a lot of money and I spent a lot of time. The trip we made to Hollywood is etched upon my mind. After all the things we've done and seen, you find another man. The things you think are useless, I can't understand.
Are you reeling in the years? Stowing away the time? Are you gathering up the tears? Have you had enough of mine? Are you reeling in the years? Stowing away the time? Are you gathering up the tears?